welcome to I Can't Do Art Live number 10, which is the final one of this series of I Can't Do Art Live. And in this one, we're going to be looking at ideas and ways to draw anything that we want to. And I know that's kind of a big claim to say that I can show you how to do that, but bear with me. And just remember a few things that when you start your journey into anything, whether it's learning to drive a car, learning to cook a recipe, learning to draw, whatever, you have to be prepared to start at the beginning. Now, we've come a long way in these last 10 weeks. Those of you that have been here all the time, we've come a long way, and you've really done some wonderful work and made some beautiful creations, and you should be hopefully feeling kind of more confident in the fact that you have absolutely the right to sit down and draw something. And I hope you've also realised that with a little bit of practice and time, much like learning to drive a car or whatever, that you're getting better and better, and therefore able to sort of enjoy it more. But the really important thing is not to set the bar too high for yourself. So think about, if we're going to do a new technique today, and I think you'll find it really helpful, I know I do, start when you go away and perhaps use it again. Start realistically, and we can work on from there. So, as usual, we're going to start with some doodling, and as I always say, that really helps kind of awaken our brain to the idea that we're using minor motor skills, and we can send those messages to our mind that this is what we're going to do. So what you need today, for those who've just joined, we need a pencil, and if you've got graded pencils, these sets of, I've got one here, I think they go from like A6 to H5 or something like that. They're helpful, but they're not essential. Just a regular box standard HB will do. A rubber is useful because, when we're doing stuff, we do need to change things sometimes, and that's fine. Pencil sharpener if you've got it. If you've got it, a little fine liner if you want to have a go at doing a little bit of pen and ink rather than just drawing. So that's fine. So what we're going to start doing this week, and I'm going to start with some of the foundation shapes that we need to get ourselves onto this stage of being able to draw actual pictures of things and etc. etc. So what I want you to do is to start by just drawing, and these do not have to be perfect, okay? These do not have to be perfect. Just try a circle, a square, a triangle, a rectangle, and an oval. And these we consider in the art world are kind of the foundation shapes of form, what we call form, that, excuse me, most things are made up of. So we're just going to have a little go at getting these shapes under our belt. You can draw them in different sizes because, in life things do come in different sizes. The triangles can be tall and thin. They can have different length sides, The rectangles can stand upright, they can be long and thin, or really quite big and almost a square. And the ovals as well can be really thin, they can be really fat like this. Okay, just have a play with those while I talk to you a little bit about drawing. So, here we go. Please, you do these. You don't even have to look at what you're doing. You can do it while you look at me and listen to what I'm talking about if you want. But just warm yourself up using these nice foundation shapes. Now, this week on the page, I made the great claim that you can draw anything at all. And ultimately, that is true. but I want to show you by how we do it in the art world, by breaking things down. So we might start, for example, I do this week. Let me show you. This is a picture of a seahorse that I drew. Now, if I were to say to people, can you just draw me that seahorse, please? You know, a lot of people might find that really quite an intimidating ask, particularly older people, as I think the older you get, the more entrenched these ideas that you can't do something get. Children, if you say to a child, draw a seahorse, they're off. They have amazing confidence, and rightly so, because they know that they are natural born artists. And this is another picture that I drew, which I hope you can see, is a water lily in pencil, obviously. And again, if I were to say, could you just draw that for me? You would probably find that really intimidating, as indeed would I, to be honest. So, what we're going to do is we're going to have a look at some techniques that help us get to that point, okay, by breaking the item down into doable pieces. So what I'm going to show you now is the same seahorse, which I hope you can see this. I have marked it up with a black pen, and I hope you can see that clearly, with the shapes that make the foundations of its form. So we have a circle where his tail curls, a nice big, an oval for his head. There's a sort of, it's not quite a triangle, but it's almost a triangle where its fins come. That line just follows the curve of the tummy. And then I've drawn a line through his head in the sort of lower third to show where his, do they call it a beak? Is it a beak? A mouth? I don't know. Maybe it's got a snout. I don't know. Anyway, so that's what I've done. I've taken it down to the basic shapes, and that's where we will start. Now, I've done this on this, but I just want to show you that it's possible to do it, excuse me, on pretty much any picture you come across. Now, this is a picture that I took last week, and it's quite a plain sort of country scene of a poppy field. But if I wanted to draw this, one of the ways that I could do it is to break it down again into its basic shapes. So these are the shapes that I need to create into the picture before I add the details, okay? And this is what we call creating form. So we're looking for the shapes within a picture that we can highlight. Now, if you have a picture that you want to copy, you can do this. You can draw straight onto it, or you can copy it straight onto your paper. But it is a bit easier if you can, with something that's a little bit complicated like this, so there's quite a lot of shapes going on, you can mark it up if you want to. But if it's a photograph or a picture that you want to copy, that you don't want to be drawing all over, then there are other ways, okay. Now, there is another technique that is also used, and we're going to go through this finding the basic shapes technique, and we're going to draw ourselves something. But there is another technique, and this is the technique that I used for drawing the water lily. And hopefully you can see on that I have drawn a grid on to the picture. So I have drawn a grid. I literally, to make it easy, because now I get really bored doing all the measuring and stuff like that. So I literally just used the edge of my ruler to dictate the size of the square. So I just moved it down, drew a line, moved it down again, drew a line like that. And then the same across that way, so that you can see... so that I could make the grid completely uniform, and so that's how I did that. Then what I did with that, I then drew a grid using the same technique on my paper, okay? And I'm going to talk about that one a little bit more in a minute, about how we get from doing that to, you know, ending up with a picture like this. Though you've probably got a pretty good idea already, but I will talk through that. But first of all, we are going to have a look at, oh, just to show you that, again, the grid system can work on any picture. So I marked up this picture as well, again with the grid system. I decided this time I didn't want as many grids, so I used a double width of the ruler to make my grid, and then I transferred the same grid onto my paper. And I'll just tell you basically what you then do is you just draw one grid at a time onto your paper. So you are just, you're not drawing, you stop drawing a scene and you start just drawing lines, and you can use the grid. So that's so far up there, so I'll draw that on my paper, I'll start that line up there and I'll finish it over here, and then, you know, you can start to draw, and you just move around one grid at a time. Now this is not cheating, okay? This has been, this technique has been used for years by artists. Excuse me, bit of a frog in my throat. I'm completely well, by the way. You may well have seen, if you've ever watched things like, you know, Landscape Artist of the Year or whatever, you may well have seen artists with something like this. Usually it's a little bit of card, so it's a bit stiffer. But they basically done the same thing. So they look, they probably hold it at arm's length and look through it, and they see the view that they are wanting to translate onto their canvas. And having these marks on it, which they can also mark up on their canvas, gives them the idea of a grid, what belongs where. And the reason they hold it at arm's length is because arm's length is a measurement that you can rely on. So if you were to hold it there, perhaps next time you picked it up, you might hold it a little bit closer, and then the lines would be moving around. Whereas if you just always hold it at arm's length like that, then you're guaranteed that what you look at is the same scale every single time. So that is something people use. And people even use these to do still lives. So if you've got your bowl of fruit or whatever, or even a portrait, you know, obviously you'd use it that way up. But it's a very commonly used guide by artists going way back in time. This has been used, this sort of gridding up, to make, to enable them to get the form of the painting in the right positions before they go in and start adding all the detail and that sort of thing. Now what often happens, and I hope you're still drawing your circles and your triangles and all that sort of thing. Blythe's watching. Hello, my darling. That's my daughter. Lovely to have you here too. Looking forward to seeing you soon. So, what often happens when people are asked to draw a picture is that they start, so you've got to draw a seahorse. Okay, so a seahorse has got a head like this and a, you know, a snout like this. And they start drawing it, and the eyes here, and they get very quickly caught up in the detail. We need to put these spikes on. And they might draw a really wonderful head, and then they come down to do the body and something doesn't look quite right, and they can't quite work out what it is. Is he too fat? Is he too thin? And they start rubbing things out and all this sort of thing. And that's often the way that people approach drawing, and it's kind of understandable, but it makes it very complicated for yourself. Until you've got the basic form of what you want to draw down, it's actually quite difficult to make sure that the scale is right and everything is in the right place before you commit to adding all the detail and that sort of thing. And then it can get frustrating, and you think, the only way I'm going to make it is by rubbing it all out, and I've invested all this time. So this way is a way of doing it without having to get to that point where you've done one wonderful bit but nothing else is quite working, and you don't really know why, and you fiddle about with it and fiddle about with it until you end up throwing it in the bin in frustration because you're so upset. So, what we are going to do is we are all going to draw this seahorse. Okay, so you're going to have a look at that. You can take a screenshot of it if you like, or I believe it is on the page if you want, but a screenshot is probably a good idea so that you can have a look and you can see the basic lines. But what I'm going to do, I'm going to talk you through it, and we're going to do it again, together rather. And I'm going to use a pencil this time. Hopefully, if I use a 3B, it should be dark enough for you to see what we're doing. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to start by drawing his body, and that's going to be our starting point. Okay, so we're going to draw an oval pretty much in the middle of the page, and quite a big one because they have quite tubby tummies like that. So there we go. And it doesn't have to be perfect, okay, because these are just guidelines. You might at some stage in the drawing, you might actually rub them out. Now, the next thing we're going to do is we're going to do a bit of measuring, but we're going to measure like the artists measure. We're not going to get a ruler out and get all stressed about centimetres and that sort of thing. One, which is the length of his body, and hold that point. Okay, so this is a guide measure. Now, if you look at the drawing, when you come to do this, when you come to translate a drawing into shapes, which you will be able to do, it takes a little bit of practice, but if you get a picture and you start thinking about these shapes and which ones apply to different bits of the picture, you'll be able to do it. So we're going to measure his tummy, and it's this long, okay? And you'll see artists doing this. You'll see them doing this when they're painting a landscape, they're measuring with their paintbrush or whatever. Now, how far, if we use that measure, how far down is his tail? And it's just a little bit more than the full length of his tummy. So we're going to measure down, make a mark there, and we're going to just draw a circle where his tail is, okay? And it's almost directly underneath. Another thing you'll see them doing is using angles as well, and that's another thing that you will find helpful. But for the moment, his tail is directly at the bottom, so we're just going to draw a circle there. And again, it doesn't have to be perfect. So the next thing we're going to draw is his head. So first of all, we need to position it correctly. So if I take another measurement across his tummy this time, and I put that there, I can see that the top of his head is as far from the top of his body as the width of his tummy. So I'm going to take the width of his tummy, put it up on top of his body, and put a mark there, and that's where his head is going to be. So I hope you can get that. And his head is another nice oval, and it's at an angle. Now, if you want to know what angle it's at, you can just put your pencil on it, and I hope you can see this, you can put your pencil on it and slide that over to your paper, and it will give you, straight away the angle that his head's at. But don't worry too much about it, because, you know, their heads move. It doesn't have to be in exactly the same position. So there we are, I've drawn my oval. I'm going to ask you to put the fan on again, please, because I'm getting a bit hot and I don't know why. So there we are, we've got three of our guidelines. So the next thing we're going to do to continue with our seahorse is we are going to identify where, in relation to the oval on his face, I'm going to call it a beak. I don't know what it's called, but I'm going to call it a beak. And I think it's just under halfway down. So I'm going to draw a line that goes just under halfway down, dead across this oval I've drawn, and take it out here, and that's where his beak, snout, nose, whatever, will go. And his eye sits just on top of that line. Okay, so we're going to draw another circle there. Nice, quite a big one, because they do have really, they have quite big eyes, and then they have a big circle of flesh around them as well. So there we have the first guidelines. Now, the next thing we need to do is to work out where this fin is going to be. Now, this one's got quite a big fin. Seahorses come in all kinds of sort of variations on this design, so it doesn't really matter whether you want a big fin or a small fin, but I chose to put a big fin, and to do the fin, I just literally mirrored this line. I just went out about a centimetre or whatever and mirrored that line from about a third of the way down and curved it in at the bottom. Okay. So then the final things we're going to do to create our basic form is we are going to do these wonderful, wonderful curves that they have around their body. Okay. Wonderful. So we're going to, if we have a good look at it, and this is the really important thing about learning to draw like this, and I must say this because it's so important, it teaches you to draw with your eyes and not your mind. One of the reasons so many of us go wrong, for want of a better word, when we're trying to replicate something is that our mind and what we think an apple looks like, or a banana, or a seahorse looks like, interferes with what we're actually seeing. But when we use these techniques, we have to really look with our eyes to be able to see where the shapes are and how they work together and all that sort of thing. So using these techniques are really strengthening your powers of observation, and that is anyone who wants to do art, being able to see with your eyes and not your mind is a real part of a skill that you can work on and work on. And, you know, you'd be amazed the difference that it can make if you trust your eyes rather than your memory. So we're going to, with that in mind, and just to say, by doing that, you're drawing the lines that you're seeing rather than thinking, I'm drawing a seahorse. At each stage, you're just thinking about the next line that you need to do. And that makes it much less scary. If someone says to you, you've got to draw a seahorse, you know, that's quite a big ask, okay? But if someone says, you just need to draw an oval, then you need to draw another oval. Breaking it down into doable pieces. So what we're going to do are these nice curves that go from his chin to the front of his tummy and from the back of his head down to the fin that we've put in. Okay, and these can be nice and curvy. So here I go. It comes out a bit and then it tucks into the back of his head like that. The front of his neck starts quite far back, and that's how you get this lovely curve. So it's not even, it's just slightly past halfway from his head. So if you put the mark there where you're going to start and a mark on his tummy where you're going to finish, all you've got to do is just join those two marks up. Okay? And then it's the same with his tail. So you can see the back of his tail starts at the bottom of the fin and is obviously going to go to the back of the circle, and the front starts at the bottom of his tummy, and it goes, not far from the back of it, because obviously it tapers, so we'll do a mark there for that one, and then you get to draw this lovely curve down from here to the back. It's quite straight, never mind, this one's going to be more bendy, and then this one all the way down to here. Okay, that's why I've made mine very thin. I can always fatten that up if I want. Let's fatten it up. And that's the joy of doing guidelines, is that you can stop at each stage and look at it and think, actually, that's not quite right, so I should draw that guideline and I will rub the old one out so I don't get confused. Incidentally, when you're using a rubber, be sure when you rub something out to just clean the corner, because otherwise when you go and rub something else out, you're going to get a dirty mark on it, and which I do all the time, by the way, and then you end up with this sort of grey smudgy paper. So let's rub out that guideline. And then at the bottom, we're just going to draw a little spiral within the circle, and then we're going to turn that into the beautiful curve on his tail. So I'm just going to draw a nice spiral like that, and then I'm going to follow that round with the inside line. And remember, you're taking it thinner and thinner as you get all the way round to the end, like that. And again, mine's a little bit wobbly, but it's something I can tidy up at another stage, and then I can rub out the circle that was there in the first place. And so we've got our tail. Mine's a little bit thinner than I want it to be, so I'm just going to fatten it up a little bit. It's a little bit wobbly at the back, so I'm just going to straighten it out a bit, make it a nicer, gentler curve, and there we are. So there we are. You should be at this stage now. You probably cracked on ahead of me. So the next thing I'm going to look at, as we're just building up our picture, I'm going to attach the fins now to the back of the seahorse. Now, these things come in all shapes and sizes, and if you're drawing a particular seahorse, you can copy it immaculately if you want to, or you can play with it a little bit because it is your piece of work. Okay, now I'm going to do a big fin on this because I think they're fancy, but I'm going to take it down a bit and then just go in with a slightly angled line like that. Remember I said, you know, it was sort of a triangle shape, so I'm just going to take that in a little bit, and that's our fin attached. And then the final thing I need to do to have my basic form ready to go is to add on this beautiful, beautiful dear little beak, mouth, snout, whatever it is. And so you can have a good look at that, okay? And you can see that it just rises up slightly. It's got a slightly turned up nose, and then goes in at an angle underneath. And so that's what I'm going to do, and then join it up to the body, okay? So there we are, we have our basic form. Okay, now that wasn't too painful, was it? Hopefully. So if you were, for example, going to do this picture, let's just say, and you decided, listen, I'm going to tell you this because there's absolutely no reason why I shouldn't. You can trace a picture if you want. There is nothing wrong with getting a bit of tracing paper or a thin piece of paper, putting it over your original and tracing out the basic form like that, okay? Artists do it. Artists use projectors and project images onto a canvas and they trace around it, okay? If that's something you want to do, that's fine, because every time you draw a line, however you draw it, you are developing muscle memory in your hand and enabling yourself to grow in confidence to get to the next stage and the next stage. So if you want to trace it, you trace it. But this is a good way of doing it if you want to kind of... I will put the seahorse with ovals on the Facebook page later, Terry. If you want to take a screenshot of it, please do. I think there is actually a picture on there. I think it might be. Let me just have a look. Oh, I've been drawing all sorts this week, following these styles. Just before we get into the detail with our seahorse, it's a pencil sharpener that I drew using the breaking it down into basic shapes method. Okay. And this is a seagull that I drew with the same method, you know, a nice oval for his body, a sort of square for his neck, another oval for his head, a little bit of a triangle for his beak, a bit of a triangle for his tail. So it was the same principle, breaking it down into doable shapes. And then, like we've done here, kind of filling in the missing bits and giving it the final overall sort of form shape that you want. So... yes, I think on the page, Terry, is a picture that is, it's gone, never mind, it's in there somewhere, but goodness knows where, is a picture like this, in actual fact. But let's carry on anyway. Okay, so the next stage is you get to add some more of the detail. Okay, so one of the obvious things about our seahorse is this spine that goes all the way down, in fact, all the way down through, because he has these sort of, it's almost like an exoskeleton. It may well be, because when I was researching this, I did come across a skeleton of a seahorse, and it did look, it did have these sort of grids on it, or it must, may just have been, you know, the dried flesh, I don't know, so they have these sort of, they're like plates on them, and spines, probably as some sort of protection, I guess. But these spines go all the way down their back. So you can just have fun with this, okay? Because, you know, they're all a little bit different. But if I hold this picture up while I do this, I'm going to give him one on his head, one on the further back, and then give him a nice big one back there. And then I'm just going to do some sort of irregular spines down his back, just to kind of kick it off, and then maybe some down here as well. And as you can see, it's already starting to look more seahorse. Now what I'm going to do now is I'm going to rub out the guidelines that I don't need. So I don't need to have these guidelines through his tummy anymore. They can go. Thank you for the work you've done. I don't need this guideline across his face anymore. I can rub that out now. So there we are, we've got him there. So the next detail that I would probably put in, I'd probably give him a pupil on his eye. Okay, and then this little fellow, I don't know if you can see that, he's got sort of a gill fin just here. Now, if you look, you'll see that under his chin, his sort of jawbone comes up like this, and then behind it is the gill. So I'm going to follow where his neck joins here, I'm going to follow that up to the line we drew across and give him a jawbone there. You could, you know, fiddle around with that a bit and put it where you want. Hang on, I sort of dropped out that guideline there. And then I'm just going to draw a little, like half a triangle without the tip back here to do his little gill, if you can see that. Okay. And that's just me copying what I see now, because now we're getting down to the detail. It's not, we've got the basic form, so that he's already looking enough like a seahorse that we don't need to worry about getting the major bits in the wrong place anymore. So the next thing is to get in this sort of armour plating pattern. And if you can see on here, and this again is about using your eyes and looking at what you see, there are three rows of armour plating that we can see. One that goes down the back, curls round, one that runs down the middle, and then one that we can only sort of see half of, and it stops just under his tummy and goes up to his neck. So we're going to draw in these three lines, and they follow the shape of his body, okay? But we're just going to do them one at a time, so we're not going to panic. We're going to think, right, I need to draw three in here, so if I divide this space up at the back of his head into three, that's where I'll start. And I'll start with the back one, and we're just going to follow it down through his body, go down tummy, take that back, and we can, if you've got a slightly fatter curve on your seahorse, you can actually take that one sort of almost completely through the centre, because as you can see, he has got sort of spines at the back here, and it's a little bit more fleshy on the insides, I guess, so he can curl it easily. Then we're going to do the next one, and that's going to come down and bow out again because of his fat tummy. It might be a pregnant male. We know that the female seahorse lay the eggs and the men carry them in their pouch and birth them. And that one's going to come down and join up just before the curl starts. If you can see, just before the curl starts, this one becomes, the one at the very front disappears, and this one in the middle becomes, so it's just two rows of armour plating going down right to his tail. Okay, and I haven't done that quite right. Because of that, I should have put his front tummy just stopping about, let me see, just about there. Thank goodness these are just guidelines, eh? What I might need to do, let me see, put that out to his tummy, take it in there. So here we are, now I've divided him up into three. I hope you can see that, and I'm sure you've done something similar, possibly even better. Getting into the detail now, we're really of the seahorse, and again this is where observation comes in, and you can see that these plates follow a slightly zigzag pattern, so they come down, go up, and then they go up a little bit more as they, because remember he's a three-dimensional creature, so we're trying to create the illusion that he's not flat, that actually these are going round his body. So what I'm going to do, looking at that picture, I'm going to start at the top, and they're obviously where his body parts are smaller, they're closer together, and where he gets bigger, they sort of stretch further apart. And I'm going to draw lines, and they're going to get slightly further apart as we go down his body, like that. And this is all we're doing, we're just drawing sort of straight lines at a slight diagonal angle, and then they're going to start, as we go down his tail, they're going to start getting closer and closer together again until we get to the bottom. Okay, and then the next one, as you will see, it bends up a little bit, not a huge amount, but just a little bit, so it looks a bit like a chevron. Keeping an eye on the time here. So there we are, you can see. Now obviously when you're drawing something like this, you are going to take a little bit more time. I am sort of rushing you through it, but I just wanted you to see that it's easier than you think if you do this, if you follow this technique. It's easier to get to the bit that is, you know, to be honest, more enjoyable than actually just drawing the basic form. Get through the stressful bit. So, and then around his tummy, I'm going to take this line up slightly higher, and if you can see, by doing that, it gives it a sort of three-dimensional, if you can imagine a ribbon wrapped around a jar or something like that as it goes away from you. There we are, so he's got a slightly three-dimensional. Now the other things that I want to add in, to add into the detail, I want to give his mouth an opening. On this little gill fin, if that's what it's called, I don't know, I'm going to put some lines because they have some sort of, I wonder what it is, probably like what your nose is made of, I can't think of the word, what is the word? For that, some sort of gristle. What's it actually called? Anyway, I'm going to do those down his spine fin as well. And again, you see, I'm doing this bit from my mind. I know this is what happens, so I'm just going to do it from my mind like this. But if you're drawing from a photograph and you want it to be picture perfect, you look at those lines. You look and see how they are and how they go. Because that's how you get, you know, we're doing a sort of generic seahorse, okay? So it comes to a bit where you can start to engage with your creative ideas of your own once you've got the basic form. But if you want to do that, if you want to do a forgery of the Mona Lisa, you need to really look at the Mona Lisa and see what she looks like. You can't apply your own imagination to that, or you won't get away with it as a forgery. So there we are. That is our basic shape. Okay. Now, To bring a pencil drawing to life, the next thing to do is to add some shading, okay? And we have done a little bit of shading. I think we did some of the Zentangles last week. What I want you to do is to just very quickly draw an oblong, divide it into four, and do this little exercise just before you hit the ground running with your shading. I just want you to practice the pressure involved in doing different darknesses of shading. So we're going to do a very light one. Now when I shade, so I don't get those sort of scribble lines, I tend to do it very much on the side of my pencil. So that is a very light shade. Then we're going to darken it up a little bit. Okay, and how you do that, it's all about pressure. You're just applying pressure, a very light pressure to get the light one, a bit more to get the mid-range, then we're going in a bit harder to get a darker line, and then when we want to go really hard, that's a lot of pressure and you need to be really pushing down on that nib, okay? So we've got our three shades. Does that make sense to you? Of course, really, there is a fourth one, which is no shading, where we just leave it as the white paper. So that is the real highlights on anything you're drawing, the highlights where the light hits so hard that it just becomes almost white, we leave it blank, okay? Or if you're fancy and you've got one of these white graphite pencils, you can use that as well. But this is one way to do it. So very hard, just have a quick practice of that, okay? Just so that you know what you're going to be doing. So while you're doing that, I did say to people that if they wanted to do pen and ink, this is a good stage. This is the stage. If you want to do this little seahorse in pen and ink, once you've got your basic form, you've got your basic detail in place, this is when you can commit and put your pen to paper and start going over your lines with your fine liner or whatever it is that you're using. So this is when you can introduce that. But for most pen and ink drawings, it is wise to get your drawing down first, your basic form and enough of the detail before you hit the shading. Get that down as lightly as you can with your pencil. And then you can start filling in the lines like that, okay? And the one other thing I'm going to say about pen and ink, because I know a few of you were really keen when I asked what you wanted to do this week, When you are shading with pen and ink, it's not the same as how you shade with pencil. And there are three basic techniques for shading with pen and ink, and I will show you them. The first one, okay, so it's just vertical lines if you want to go shading. Okay, so if you're drawing a shape like that, you do your hatching, you cross hatching, and then you lighten it up as you get over to the light on that side as well. A bit dark there. The other technique is basically a scribble, but you scribble in a figure of eight, so it's like this. Okay, if you want to do shading, and it's quite simply, you do more figures of eight where you want it darker, so we've got the sunlight coming from over here, so this side's light, that side's dark, we do figures of eight down here, and these are tiny drawings, so it's quite difficult, and then as we get over here, we do less of them, okay, so that's your figure of eight shading, and the final one, is dots. And I know it seems really crude, but actually all three of these techniques are really good and maps all of them in a finished picture, because some might work better with one part of the drawing, others might work better with the other. So to do the shading on this, we use dots, dark where the light is the least, obviously. And then we get lighter round to the front, like that. That is a really, really, really It's called a snout reader. Thank you. At last we know. Well, if you've not learned anything tonight, we've learned that a seahorse's nose is called a snout. Fantastic. I quite like a beak though, but I hear you, the snout. So there you are. That's a basic introduction to shading with pen and ink, okay? Otherwise, it's kind of similar to using a pencil, it's much more of a commitment. Once you've got that line down, there's not much going back. So basic form, and your drawing view, how to shade. So I'm working on the assumption with this, and I didn't copy this shading, I did it myself. So I'm working on the assumption that particularly with these plates, that the light is these lines you can see a slight and hardly touch those, but where they dip in, where these sort of plates on the plating is, I'm shading them dark at the top and down, and that gives them that sort of three-dimensional look. So if you can see what I mean, not exactly like this, they actually follow so that you get that light ridge. What we're going to do, and if you were to look at a picture, actually, my pencil needs sharpening, that shading, it's got a bit soft. Oh, it's got a bit soft. So they kind of, we're going to follow just the top shape of each squares that we've done, like that. Can you see what I'm doing? Okay, so that gives us our raised bit here. And then we're going to shade dark at the top, getting lighter and lighter and lighter. And you can fiddle about with this, okay? Put a dark around the edge, and then lighter to the next one. And then the same up here, so it's dark at the top, and getting, well, I've got my concentrating face on, you probably have. I'm surprised I haven't got my tongue sticking out. I sometimes do that when I'm concentrating. And then the same again here, dark at the top. And getting lighter and lighter to the bottom. Now, I'm not going to draw all of these in. We've been here for quite a while. It's quite a pleasant thing. It's a little bit zen doing this because it is repetitive. And here we go, down again. And as you can see, by doing that, we are actually leaving this ridge. Actually, I need to go right down to that line that's across, or it looks a bit weird to have that guideline showing. So we take that right down to there and carry on. We just follow the shape. And we do the dark at the top, and lighter and lighter to the bottom. I'm doing this upside down, I'm doing it a bit crudely, but you get the idea, and that's how we go down. Okay? So when you complete that, you will see that you have a real sense of, you know, you can see what's closest to you is lightest. That's the basic rule of shading, I think. What's closest to you with things like this is lightest, and what's furthest away is dark when you're doing, you know, the ins and outs of a thing like this. So the spines and things that stick out from him are the light bits, and the bits that go in are going to be darker. It's as simple as that. Now, with his face, I've shaded underneath his chin heavier than on top of his head, because it stands to reason, you know, that the light would cast more shadow underneath his face. So just to show you what I'm doing there, shading under his chin, and you can go quite dark, you know, you can go, as long as you've got that sort of contrast, or you can keep it fairly light and go, you know, almost to nothing. The thing is, the trick is, and it does take a little bit of practice, is to get it so you can't see where you go from one grade to another. And I think, as I said last week, there are actual tools that help you smudge without getting it all over your fingers. Well, I don't own one of those tools. I've just bought one from Amazon because I make such a mess otherwise. But I do smudge with my finger and then live to regret it, because I'm just going to take his face line so it meets up with his feet with a nice gentle curve. And this is another part of just adding in sort of detail and fine-tuning it so that he doesn't look like he's completely just made up of shapes. You know, you're kind of fleshing him out. It's like you've sort of drawn a skeleton and now we're putting the flesh and the detail onto him like that. Okay, and so we get right up to the top of the head and it can be quite light. I gave him a shadow around his eye. You can see that, just to sort of emphasise his eye. I don't even know if it was there in the picture, but I chose to do it just to give his eye a little bit of emphasis. I don't even know if it works, but I liked it. And that's the thing with drawing. You can play, you know, and if you don't like how it looks, rub it out and start again, you know, or at least, at the very least, you've learned how not to do it, you know, for the next time or whatever. And then I'm going to leave the top of his beak quite light because I'm working on the assumption there's quite a bit of light on there. One other thing, of course, you can do if you want to put a highlight on something is literally just rub out, you know, just highlight it by rubbing out the colour. So in that case, I've given him a sort of like a sheen on the top of his head, just like that. And then the same with his spines. Now, I chose to do his spines quite dark because I wanted them to, but I left a light bit on them at the top, so the light is just catching the top of them like that, and it just makes it look a bit more, you know, a bit more finished, I suppose, a bit more realistic, something like that. I'm not a great fan of drawing realistic art. I prefer to do kind of slightly abstract things and, you know, play a bit fast and loose with the rules myself. But and so doing these drawings, which I've done in the last few weeks, have been a bit of a challenge. But I've actually quite enjoyed it, and it's certainly improved my drawing technique. So you might beg to differ looking at this, but you know, I have quite enjoyed it. You know, and I've been, you know, pleasantly surprised by what I've been able to achieve in the long run. Now, when you're doing an eye, I'm just going to give you a little tip here, because you can probably work out from this the rest of it. So if you're, you know, if you're getting, doing your fins here, you might want to start dark, you might want to darken up these gristly lines, start dark and go lighter. You get the idea now of sort of, maybe it'll be lighter at this end of it than it would at that end. You know, you can't completely go wrong with shading, particularly with things like this. If you're doing it from a picture, that's one thing I must say. If you're doing a pencil drawing from a picture that is a colour picture, you are not drawing colour. Do not try and recreate colours with with your pencil, because it's almost impossible. What you are drawing is light and shade. So you're picking out the light things, which might be the lighter colour things, but what you're actually picking out is the light and dark. So if you can see, for example, I know I'm loading you with information here, you don't have to remember it, you can always watch it back if you want to and think, what was she banging on about? How when you're translating a picture that's colour into black and white, you do the darkest things with the darkest shading and the lightest things with the lightest shading. So yes, in some ways that means that you're kind of working with colour if you've got dark and light in the picture. There is my picture of this. So obviously some of these petals are much darker than others. And I've kind of represented that a bit by using dark and light, but what you're really drawing when you're doing pencil drawings is you are drawing light and shade rather than, you know, trying to emulate different colours, you know. So if it's got a green bit and a blue bit, don't think, well, I'll do the blue bit really dark and the green bit a bit lighter, because that's not really what you're doing. You're just choosing the darkest things and making them the darkest, and the lightest things making them the lightest, and then everything in between. Cass says you should have stuck to a pencil. You'd always go back and try again. And actually, if you're not happy with it, you know, if you're doing it with a pen, drop the pen and start going over it with a pencil, because you can make that pencil pretty dark, let me tell you. But But or do half and half, do half of it in ink and half of it in pencil, and see which one you prefer. It's a good kind of exercise in, you know, what's my thing? Because that's a big part of thing. Trying lots of different things, trying to do, you know, lots of different styles, which I hope is what we've done in these 10 weeks, gives you lots of options, you know, to think, oh, now, which of those weeks did I really like? I'm going to go and, you know, explore that a little bit more, see what I can do. Anyway, I have gone way, way over. It's nearly 6 o'clock, nearly 8 o'clock, my goodness. So I'm going to stop there. I think you've got enough information there. I hope you've got a seahorse that you're happy with. You know, and I hope that you've enjoyed these last 10 weeks. I have. It's been a challenge, but I have enjoyed it, and it's been you know, really, really good for me to prove to myself that I can do something like this. So I'm going to say for a final time, if you do want to contribute, I will put the link on. I'm not going to bang on about that. It's entirely up to you. I did this for free for people anyway, for me. So please send me your work. I'm going to keep the group open, and so please feel free to, and I will occasionally put up stuff so you can have a look and think, oh, I might have a look at that, and I might have a look at that, you know, and it would be nice if we can keep the group going, you know, even without the live streams. Feel free to have a look at my iCandy YouTube channel and have a look back on some of these videos, and in the meantime, keep creating. Please keep creating and keep sending it through to me. I've really enjoyed doing this with you, and I hope you have too. So please take great care of yourselves, and I'll see you again sometime. Much love. Bye-bye. Thank you.